This morning, if you don't have a sermon outline, just lift your hand and these men will be glad to give one to you. If you're clicking on our website and about to watch this message from online, there is a button that you can click down below to download the notes for this message. Our church believes in studying the Bible. We seek to study the Bible expositorily. We seek to study the Bible very often phrase by phrase or at least section by section so that we can get a proper understanding of what God is saying to us. This morning, you don't need to hear Andrew Coleman or Ben Nistor or Lucas Almeida or any other pastor's words so much as you need to hear the very words of God. And so this morning, we come to that, and we come to a new book of the Bible. We come to an Old Testament book of the Bible. We have studied, certainly, over the last 7 years, passages from the Old Testament, but we've not done an Old Testament book. And so this morning, welcome to message number one from the book of Hosea. We will not move as slowly as we move through John or as we move through Titus. The literature is a little bit different, and so we will move a little bit quicker through that. This will be a few weeks long, but this morning we're going to be starting our look at an Old Testament passage from the book of Hosea. And the Hosea is an intriguing book. It is a passionate book. It is a gloriously passionate book with some narrative, that means some story, but a whole lot more commentary on God's people, and listen to this, God's love. And God's love is a scandalous love. You say, what in the world? Scandalous. We think of that as negative. Why would you use the word scandalous to describe God's love? What is a scandal? Think about that with me. If something happens that's a complete scandal, you look at it and you say, well, this ought not have happened. That's what a scandal is. It's a surprise with a turn, and it's an injustice. It appears to be a corruption of fairness. And so we often use the word scandal to describe something that is out of bounds and even negative. But in this case, we're looking at the word scandal as we look and we see that this is not what fairness is all about. This is not something that makes sense to our sensibilities of what is right and wrong. In fact, it goes against that. And when we begin to really see the love of God, we see that it is a scandal. And it is the greatest scandal that you could ever hope for to fall your way. And so this morning we come to look at Hosea. Now, some of you are kind of thinking about Hosea. Where in the world is Hosea? I'd like everybody, if you would, to turn to your table of contents in your Bible. So let's take a little bit of pressure off here. Turn to the table of contents. Some of you are brand new really to studying the Bible. In fact, there's some red Bibles in front of you, in the pew back in front of you. Pull one of those things out. Just grab it. You'll learn something. You'll get something out of it. Notice this with me, that there are 66 books of the Bible, 39 in the Old Testament and 27 in the New Testament. And down there in your listings of this, you see it starts in the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and then it goes right on through on the other side, maybe is Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, and down through a bunch of names of individuals, you will find the book Hosea listed. On my Bible, it is page number 751. I'd like for everybody to tell me what is the page number that it says that Hosea starts from in your Bible. 1, 2, 3. Okay, good. Turn there now, wherever that is for you. Only point where relativity is okay in this message. So notice here with me, we come to this little letter. Now, what's interesting, and you have your outline there in front of you, I've put a timeline here to just kind of get a little bit of orientation. This is a very rough timeline. This is not very specific. But I want you to begin to see. Many of you have heard the messages and the accounts through the Old Testament of God working and moving, but no one's ever made it really in order for you. I am so proud. I have spoken with a few people in our church this week and in the last couple of weeks that have begun really reading through the Bible over the last couple of months. And one person said to me this week, "Pastor, you'd be proud of me. I've made it to Exodus. I'm going for it." And so I am proud of that. And but even more, that we would be a people who begin to say, man, these are the words of life, and God's story, God's work, not God's fairy tale, but the account of how God has been moving through human history is the story of a scandalous love, a love that we do not deserve, a love that is unjust when it comes to looking at our lives and what all we are in our fallenness, in all of God's holiness and his righteousness. As we begin to see the true message of the Bible, it's an amazing, amazing, progressive unfolding, showing us who he is. So notice here with me in the gray box on your outline, you notice who's the name at the very top? Adam. Okay, so we begin with Adam and Eve, Adam being the first man. And then shortly thereafter, we of course see the fall and so forth, that's not counted here, but you see Noah. And then after Noah, there's a period of time, many generations that are there. And then right around what is generally identifiable, around the year 2000 BC, 2000 years before Christ, Abraham and his son Isaac and Jacob and eventually Joseph. And if you've ever wondered, how did the Israelites get over into bondage in Egypt where Moses had to come set them free? Notice here, God delivered God's people and brought them into Egypt in order to escape a famine and to show his goodness, to show his righteousness, even through the difficult life of Joseph, who was sold into slavery to a caravan headed for Egypt by his brothers, and then falsely accused, sitting in prison. Think about all of that. He interprets some dreams, and before you know it, God has exalted him to be the prime minister of Egypt. And then his brothers come in the midst of a famine, needing help. They do not recognize him. When they finally do recognize him, they realize this is the brother we sold into slavery. He's going to kill us. And that's where Joseph says those beautiful words, "What you meant for evil, God meant for good." And then we see the beauty of God's plan unfolding. And then as time goes on, we see that the time in Egypt by Pharaoh's hand becomes a very hard time. 430 years later, you see, so there's large time gaps here. 430 years later, the Egyptians have made slaves out of the Hebrews, and then eventually they are crying out to God, and God hears their prayer to deliver them, and he raises up a man miraculously out of the house of Pharaoh to deliver them. All through this, we see God's delivery, God's working, God's scandalous love as we go. Moses delivers them out of Egypt. Moses does not make it to the promised land. We see the judges begin. The judges come and lead the nation of Israel, but the people begin seeing other kings around them, and they say, "We want a king. We want a king. The other nations have a king. We want a king." And God says, "Let me be your king." And they say, "No, we want a king." And here we go with the kings. And so we go from the judges to the kings, Saul, and then the David, and we mark David's rulership around 1,000 years before Christ, and then Solomon, and then the kingdom is divided. And this is an important part, just very, very basically. Notice here, you see Israel is to the north and Judah is to the south, and the glorious story of God's people continuing to run away from him, and even with wicked kings running away from them, but God not leaving them in their folly. And this really is the message of Hosea, because Hosea is a prophet that prophesies in the northern kingdom, the kingdom of Israel primarily, and we see that he is one of those minor prophets that is declaring what God says to be right and holy for God's people, even in the midst of their sin. And then God does an amazing thing through Hosea. He even gives a life illustration, a life biographical illustration through the life of Hosea. So you see there the major and the minor prophets. Would you just circle that, those two words, minor prophets? And then right underneath that, Hosea. So he is prophesying, he is preaching to God's people during his life. And what we're going to study over the next few weeks is about 25 years of the idea of his messages and the message that he had for Israel. And then we see down at the bottom, there's of course various captivities and being carried away. Eventually they return to Jerusalem, and you see there the message of the Old Testament goes quiet at around 400 BC. And so there's around 400 years of silence as we come to the promised King Messiah, the one who would come and pay for our sins. So we wind up there with right around zero. Some would say 4 to 6 BC, but right around zero that Christ is born. So notice on the right-hand side, let's catch a few things, and we're going to see these threads as we go through our study. The first thing is Hosea is the first of the minor prophets. So there's several minor prophets, and Hosea is the first one. The message was only shorter, fill this in, the message was only shorter, not less important. The major prophets being Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Isaiah, they're only major prophets because their books are much longer. These are much shorter. Some of these are very, very short. Hosea is one of the longer of the minor prophets. Notice the next point here. Hosea was a real preacher. He was a real preacher sent by God to Israel with a real life, fill it in, illustration. You know, preachers look for illustrations. Preachers want illustrations because illustrations help us understand important truths. And so God knows our human hearts. God knows our minds. He knows that we are story-oriented people. We love stories. That's the way all human beings are this way. Life is a story. We love to hear other stories. Sometimes they are real stories. Sometimes they are fictional stories with a message. But we're a people. I mean, just look at how much drama and the arts tell story. Last Friday, when we did the lip sync contest, going through creation, fall, redemption, glory, each part of those was a story. We were storytelling with things like the Eagles and the Beatles and, you know, all kinds of things. Things that would make most pastors like me cringe, in which it did occasionally. But it was a glorious picture of using art to reclaim the culture. We're reclaiming the culture, and we're telling the story of the gospel. And so here we see that there's an illustration, and it starts right at the beginning of Hosea, and that's where we'll start in just a moment. But it's not only an illustration, but it's also an important message. God has a message that is powerful not only for the nation of Israel, 800 BC, but he also has a message that is very important for us. Notice the next part here. We need to remember as we come into the book of Hosea that Israel was not like just any other nation. Israel was a nation that was betrothed to God as his people. We see that in Genesis chapter 12, there's a promise made to Abraham. And then we see in Genesis chapter 15 that a covenant is made between God and Abraham and his people. And God is saying the world is going to be blessed. In fact, last Sunday, we heard the story from Edgar Aponte of Abraham with his son, Isaac, and how God shows himself faithful in providing the sacrifice that would come to set his people free. But the picture is that Israel was not like the Phoenicians. It was not like the Philistines. It was not like the Assyrians or the Babylonians. It was to be a different nation living for a different high king. Notice the next part here. Israel had repeatedly, when we get to the book of Hosea and we come to this point, Israel had repeatedly relied on pagan kingdoms for security and help. Now, you may want to put to the end of that, instead of God. I probably should have put that in the notes. Instead of God. God had said, you rely on me for security. I am the high king that created everything. I can protect you and give you what you need. God said, you rely on me to be the provision for your needs. Instead of trusting God for his protection and his security, they went out on their own with their pagan kings that were ruling over the nation of Israel. And here they go, going after pagan kingdoms, gaining help, forming alliances, not trusting in God. Now, human beings are really good at saying, well, you know, I know what God said, but this is real life. And God is saying, and I'm not. So before we come too hard on the ancient Israelites, we see that very often we do the same thing, and we're going to see this throughout our study in the coming weeks. Notice here with me that not only did they rely on pagan kingdoms, but they repeatedly worshiped pagan deities. And this is a massive no-no to the High King of Heaven. The High King of Heaven says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." And this is the one true God. And God had revealed himself to them. God had delivered them time and time again. God had shown them who he was and that he was real. This is, go read your Old Testament, and you begin to see these glorious pictures of God saying to this people, I love you, trust me, look to me, listen to me, obey me, stay with me, and you'll be safe, and you will be okay. And then, amazingly enough, even after seeing miraculous event after miraculous event, very often they go and they worship the pagan deities around them. They look at the Philistines, and they say, look at their God. We want to worship a God like theirs. We want something we can see. Even after being delivered from Egypt, even while they're in the wilderness, before they even get to the promised land, God has done a great work. And what do? They pull all of their gold, melt it down, thinking Moses is dead. He's left us. And while they're down in the camp with Aaron, they form a calf and they begin worshiping a golden image, something made with their own hands. You see, the human heart is made to worship, and we live in a fallen world, and we are often prone to worship other things besides God. And this is one of the great messages of the Bible, that we are to come and to worship him. Now, the interesting thing about this, and the very sad and sick thing about this, is that next to the last one there, Israel had repeatedly worshiped pagan deities, namely Baals, where there's not just one Baal, but there are multiple Baals or Baals. And notice here with me, in all sorts of distorted sexual perversions. And so their sexuality was even involved as they're looking to the God of fertility. They're looking to the God of the weather. They're looking to the God of the crops, wanting provision, desiring provision. And Satan had come and formed these ideas of the other deities, including the Baals. And the Baals would say, you come and you devote yourself to me. You devote yourself to my worship. And you go through my ways. And the Baals had prostitutes that would come and just come and bring all sorts of perversion and distortion of everything that God had designed to be right. Everything that God had designed in our human bodies to be male and female together, husband and wife, this beautiful picture of intimacy, of goodness, of purity. And Baals were simply distorting every bit of that and making a mockery of what God had originally designed. That's why your sexuality is such a big deal to God, even in this day and time. What you do with your body, the way God designed you and the way he made you, not only with your voice and with your hands and your feet, but just everything about you, your procreation abilities, all of that is designed for his glory, in his purity, in his way. And yet Satan loves to play upon our senses. He loves to play upon desires of the human heart that can be distorted. And that's exactly what he's doing when he is bringing Israel out to worship the pagan deities of others. And then we see God in his high king, and the high king of heaven, after all that he has done, looking at his nation that he has been so good to, and here they go again, running away. Notice the last one here. In Hosea, we will see that God was revealing his, this is so important, his unrelenting love. Amazing, unrelenting love that forgives and it corrects and it restores his people to himself. This God is so good that even after being completely rejected and denied, despite his goodness and his graciousness, and we run in our sin, we run away from him, God in his goodness says, if you're mine, you're my people, I'm going to come and I'm going to get you and I'm going to correct you and I'm not going to let you go. I'm going to restore you to myself when you should be cut off and damned, when you should be cut off and condemned. I'm going to come get you. Because you are mine, and I will not have you go to another. Very often we see the harshness of the condemnation of our own sin as we run from God, and God brings a judgment. God brings a correction. But we also see in Proverbs that whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. Whom the Lord loves, he corrects. You say, well, he's never corrected me. I think I'd ask, does he love me? Have I been running away from his correction, or have I been ignoring his correction? I think I would begin to say, Lord, am I yours? Because you see, the fool runs in his folly with no regard for God, and all of his ways seem prosperous. And we often look at them and we say, man, there's nobody that opposes him. He seems to run in this way, and the fool finds his folly in the end. And here we see that the godly very often are chastened. And some of you might say, well, God must really love me a lot because he keeps chastening me. And he keeps chastising me, and he keeps disciplining me. And I would say that you would be right to say, bless the Lord. Amen. May he keep me. May he keep me in him and restore me to himself. Let's look very quickly at the passage that is here. It starts off with a scandal, a massive scandal, and really all three chapters at the beginning, chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3, depict this scandal. We're just going to look at the first few verses and pick a little bit as we go. Look at Hebrews. Good night. I'm going to get it right here in a second. Hosea. Let's all say Hosea. Okay, that helps me. Hosea chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, and look at the box on the top of the page. The word of the Lord came to Hosea, son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, and the kings of Judah, in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. So we're seeing here that the history is real. We're seeing here that it's specific. And if you go back through the lineage, if you go back through the histories, you will see that these kings ruled. And we have about 30 years of just constant change within their leadership. 30 years of six different kings, and three of them being assassinated by someone else. So this is not a godly regime. This is not a good time and a high moment in the nation of Israel. This is a messy time. This is a time where, because of their sin and all of their running and their evil kings, they are experiencing great difficulties and trouble. Notice here with me, he goes on. So in the midst of this troubled time, look what happens. Look what God does. In verse 2, when the Lord first spoke through Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, go take yourself a wife of whoredom and have children of whoredom. For the land commits great whoredom by forsaking the Lord. Verse 3, so he went and took Gomer. Circle the word Gomer. That is the woman that he took. That is the woman that he married, the daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. Now, he would have three children. The first one is clearly from him. But then we see that there are other children born, but because of her lifestyle and because of her life and what she was doing, we look at this and we say, wow, we've often said the patience of Job. Well, what about the patience of Hosea? Here we see the scandal. Look what it says in verse 2. The Lord first spoke through Hosea. So here's the beginning. And he's speaking through Hosea. He's speaking to Hosea. Look what it says. The Lord said to Hosea, go take a wife. So fill this in under that. Chapters 1 through 3 is Hosea's real life illustration. So we're getting down to the illustration. Every preacher wants an illustration. Hosea just didn't know it was going to be him. And Hosea just didn't know the cost of this illustration was going to be for him. Notice this. Hosea's real life illustration is marriage to a promiscuous woman. Marriage to what we would say is promiscuous Gomer. Now, promiscuous means someone who can't stay at home, someone who is strange, someone who's looking, someone who is sexually preoccupied in going out after others. Someone who is not living according to a moral standard of what God would say is right. Now, there's not evidence that she was a harlot before she became married. There's not evidence that she was a prostitute before she came. But, you know, Gomer knew where to look. Excuse me. Hosea knew where to look. And he came to Gomer, and by God's command and by God's call, Hosea obeys the Lord. And the first part of his ministry in this is that he is doing what the Lord had called him to do. Number one, I want you to see out of this, and I want us to just kind of notice this, that as preachers or as parents or as God's people, very often more is caught from our lives than taught by our mouths. You say, well, that's a common theme. We often hear that, you know, more is caught than taught. We say, yeah, but, you know, we don't really meditate on that very often. And I want us to meditate on the fact that Hosea's message was starting in an illustration. And God knew that the people were going to look at Hosea's life and they were going to go, wow. What is he doing? And then as we see the story unfold, as we see Gomer leave Hosea and go out with other men, let me tell you that they knew what was happening. They knew that she wasn't at home. They knew her reputation. And then they see him, by God's call, as we're going to study and read, he keeps going after her in bringing her home. He keeps going after her. Amazingly, he keeps going after her and paying her debts to her lovers, feeding her, and she doesn't even know who's bringing her food because Hosea is being faithful to God. You say, well, that is unjust. That is crazy. Who would ever do that? And that is the whole point of what we're seeing here, is that God is showing the scandalous love that he has for his people. God is showing us through this real illustration that seems unimaginable to us that God has a love and he can empower us for a love. So notice this, God's message process is costly. If you haven't already filled that in, fill that in. God's message process is costly. I want you to think with me about the first sacrifices being offered up to God. Cain and who? Abel. What did it cost Abel? His life. Abel, first person murdered on the planet. Here we see Abel, because he had offered a righteous sacrifice, because he had offered a sacrifice in faith, that he is condemned, envied by his wicked brother, and murdered. Notice Joseph. We've already talked about Joseph. Joseph, not to any fault of his own, had the favor of his father, and his brothers hated it. And they sell him into slavery. And then after slavery, he survives that, and he's in Potiphar's house. He's falsely accused, and he sits in prison for years and years. Here we see God's message and God's work has a great cost. Zechariah, Jeremiah, John the Baptist. Jesus' own beloved cousin, his head is cut off for Jesus' sake. Stephen is the first martyr to be stoned to death. He's the first martyr of the New Testament in the New Testament church. If you go and you study Christian history, notice the next one here. All of the apostles give their lives for the sake of the gospel. And part of the reason was so that the world around them would say, well, you know what? They're not doing it for their own gain. If I remember right, they crucified Peter upside down, and they went after them. They were stoned to death, and they were mocked and chased. And eventually, many of them were put to death by sword or by other means. And then we look at the grand message of God through Jesus. And what did we do with Jesus? Jesus, the innocent Son of God, the only one that truly did not deserve a wicked death, is nailed to the cross, and we see cursed is he who is hanged on a tree from Deuteronomy, and indeed we see that Christ. Now, some of you turned the page over and you did the wrong thing because you got to go back. Look at this. Hebrews chapter 11. I want you to see this. The great hall of faith. In fact, you can write hall of faith underneath Hebrews 11. Notice what it says here. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goat, destitute, afflicted, mistreated. We even see James saying, not many of you should become teachers because there's a stricter judgment that is coming for them. The message is hard. The message that God gives to us is hard. And even with our parenting, you know, it would be so easy if they weren't looking at us and watching the way they lived. If they just did what we said and didn't look at our lives, it'd be so much easier, right? But more is caught than taught. And that's where we begin Hosea. We're beginning Hosea with this massive illustration that is going to show us something about God. Now turn your page over, very safe, very good. Here we go. Notice here with me, number two. Not only does the message start with an illustration, but number two, Hosea's real life illustration would vividly expose Israel's great unfaithfulness, their unfaithfulness, and their injury to the Lord. Their unfaithfulness and their injury to the Lord. You say, wait a minute. God is the high king of heaven. He is impenetrable. There is nothing that can injure the Lord. Well, you just hang around for a little bit. We're going to recognize part of that reality, but we're also going to recognize the glorious nature in which God allows us into his heart. And there are passages in Hosea that will cause us to realize that our God is a God who causes himself to be vulnerable to us in love. And he causes himself to be open to us. He causes himself to be involved with us emotionally. This is not an unfeeling God that cannot be affected by us. This is a God who says, I come to love you as the greatest lover of all, and I call you to love me as the one who has loved you first. And so we see in Hosea that this illustration is a picture of the unfaithfulness of Israel and their injury to the Lord. And I've underlined this in the screen, but I want you to underline this. Hosea chapter 2 and verse, or chapter 1 and verse 2. Notice what it says. Go take yourself a wife of whoredom, and underline this, for the land commits great whoredom by what? Forsaking the Lord. The reason God wants him to do this is to show something. And what God is showing is that the nation of Israel is unfaithful to God. And they're unfaithful to him over and over. Look at Hosea chapter 3 and verse 1. That's also part of this little section of this biographical illustration. Look at Hosea chapter 3 and verse 1. And the Lord said to me, and this is after she's gone out and come home and then left again with the other guy. We see this going back and forth. Notice this. And the Lord said to me, go, and I've underlined it, go again and love a woman who is loved. Look what it says. By another man, is an adulteress. even as the Lord loves the children of Israel. Underline that. Even as the Lord loves the children of Israel, though they turn to what? Other gods. And so this illustration is very intentional. It's very intentional that when they see this prophet obeying God and marrying a woman who's not going to be faithful to him, having children with her, and all of the pain and all of the agony of her unfaithfulness, and going after her again, going to pay her debts, the picture is, this is what you do, Israel. This is what you do over and over and over to a good and gracious and loving God. You keep going after other gods. You keep going after, and you go a-whoring, looking to see what they might give, instead of the one who has loved you purely and rightly. Powerful imagery. In fact, number three is that imagery in the idea of matrimony. This is important to God. This is why he made marriage. This is the picture. We see it here, not only from Genesis 1 and 2, but now we come to this imagery of matrimony, with this imagery of marriage. Notice number three. The imagery of matrimony, or the marriage of God's people to God himself, is found throughout the Old and the New Testaments. Marriage was not invented by God. Marriage was not invented by man. All of you all should have gone, ooh. Stone him. No, don't do that. No rocks in the balcony, you guys. Marriage, it's commonly, you know, just kind of the way our culture looks at things. They don't know the history. They don't look at the history. They don't look at it very often in any type of a true academic sense and scholarly way. Somebody writes something and they just say, well, you know, marriage can be traced back, whatever. And they start pontificating about marriage and they have no idea the real picture of the history of marriage. We see in this picture of the Old Testament that God immediately establishes marriage between a man and a woman for his glory and for their good. Sharing his goodness of procreation. How good is it that God would allow us to join him in creating? You hold that baby for the first time and you just look at her or you look at him and you go, wow, this came from me. And everybody else is amazed too that this baby came from you. But you just look at that and you go, wow, this is amazing. That God would allow me and my wife, or me and my husband, to see this come to fruition, to share in this joy, in this beauty. God says, go fill the earth in this beautiful picture. You see, God wants us to have an earthly example of a heavenly relationship with him. God is saying, I want this intimacy with you. And you can't quite see it yet because y'all messed it up and you've fallen and it's distorted. But I'm here to restore it. I can help you restore it. I can restore it through you. And then he's saying, this is what I want with you. You see, he's a relational God. And he gives us this. Look under number three. This is as deep and profound as any human experience can be to illustrate the intended relationship that God has designed between himself and his people. So he's doing it through marriage. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 31. This is a quotation of Genesis 2:24, right at the beginning, when God creates this. And so Paul is writing in Ephesians 5, many, many thousands, hundreds of years later, certainly thousands of years later, he's showing this picture. And look what he says. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one. Now look at the next verse. Then Paul adds in Ephesians 5:32, so the very next verse, he says, this is a great mystery, and I take it to mean Christ and the church. Now, I don't really like that translation, I take it to mean. In fact, I would like you to line through that. Just mark out, I take it to mean. A better translation from the Greek is this. And I am speaking about Christ and the church. And so in the process of putting this together, I used a paraphrase of that translation as opposed to the actual ESV. And I do like the way the ESV says it and the NIV says it. It says, I am speaking about Christ in the church. So here's the picture. This picture of earthly wedding, this picture of earthly marriage, is the picture that we see here in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 32 of Christ in the church, God and his people. That's the reason marriage is such a big deal. Now, not only is there the imagery of matrimony in this beautiful passage where we can learn much, and the picture becomes even more powerful because of Gomer's waywardness, Gomer's rejection of this, but look at Revelation chapter 19 and verse 6 through 9. In the final climactic scene in heaven, when Christ will finally be wedded to his bride, this is the church. The bride is the church. This is who God's people are. That we see this final marriage supper of the Lamb, as Revelation chapter 19 described. This is what we have to look forward to. The betrothed will finally be wedded and consummated together in the final scene in heaven, when all is going to be renewed and all is going to be made bright. Now, not only the image of matrimony, but number four, we also see the gross adultery. And I've left these in because I want you to focus on this a little bit. I just really want you to think about this. The gross adultery of Gomer mirrors our gross unfaithfulness to God. You say, Pastor, you're offending me. I'm not offending you. This text is to offend you. You see, our human hearts are prone to wander. In fact, the hymn writer would say, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, O take and seal it for thy courts above. You see, we are prone to go love other gods. We are prone to go love. You say, no, I am not. I have no idols in my house. I don't have any other holy books from other religions. What are you talking about? Well, I mean, you may drive what you worship. I don't know. You may live in what you worship. You may go on vacation in what you worship. You may look and just fawn over and watch hour after hour after hour of whatever type of entertainment, whether it be sports or just, you know, oh my goodness, Hallmark, or whatever it is. I don't know. That's like purgatory. I don't understand that. But we worship all kinds of things. We worship all kinds of things around us. Whenever we begin to become enamored and live with the things that are around us and escape to the things around us, you see, we're worshiping other gods. When we can't wait to get home, to get to the cabinet where that stuff is that takes the edge off of our stressful day, we find our solace, we find our relief in a substance, or we find it in a certain type of entertainment, or we find it in the arms of someone besides God and his intention for us and our mate, we start to see that we are worshiping other things. Maybe it's when you can't wait to go click and see what the market did for you today. I can't wait to, I mean, this is going to be, when we refuse to give our tithes and our offerings to God, you know what we're saying? We're saying, I worship my own security. I mean, I got to be ready for that rainy day. I have to think about me instead of first fruits giving, of saying, God, I trust you. I trust you with what I have. I trust your hand. You see, we can start to be like the Israelites that go run after the Assyrians or go run after the Egyptians looking for help and security instead of looking to and listening to God. I've left some blanks here. Notice it says, Gomer goes a-whoring. This is the picture of the illustration. Gomer goes whoring and Israel goes whoring. That's the point. And we go whoring when we worship other things, when we rely upon other things, when we don't look and listen to God. Because God is saying, I want you to worship me and me alone. I want you to trust in me and me alone. I want you to walk with me, and I want you to walk with me and my people. This is what I want you to do. I don't know what those blanks are for your life, but I think that this weekend you need to take a little bit of time and you need to say, God, what are my gods that I run to instead of you? What are the things that I put in front of you? And I'm hesitant to name any more of them because I'll miss yours. I don't want to miss yours. I want you to evaluate what gets in the way of me. Maybe it's just busyness. Maybe it's just our, you know, Americans are crazy. I mean, we run stressful lives, running from one thing to another, maybe job to job to job to job to make a little bit more, or maybe event to event, event to kids event, to kids event, kids event, kids event. We seem to just cram it, and then we spend all of our time looking at what everybody else is doing. Wow, whoa, look at that, look at that. And I mean, and very often that makes us even want to go make more money, and very often that makes us want to go to that waterfall too and see this and do that and have that too. And before you know it, we're worshiping the gods of this life instead of the high King of heaven who says, I love you so much, I lay down my life for you. Would you take time to fill out those and confess them to God? I want to encourage you to get alone with God. Say, Lord, what if I'm going to trade anything for you, what is it? Speak to me. Show me. And let me just say to you that Gomer's going off and sleeping with other men wasn't the greatest injury to Hosea. And just like when we go off and we do these other things, those are not the greatest injury. You see, all of our behavior, the words of our mouth, and the things that we do, you know where they come from? They come from the heart. And so God is always after the heart. He's always interested, not about so much about what all you do and whatever you don't do. I mean, we as humans, we love to exalt what you do and what you don't do. And Jesus most certainly said, if you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. If you love me, you're going to do the things I say. So there's no doubt that our actions matter, but our actions simply reveal what's going on down in the heart and our values. And so when we close our heart and we say no to God's prompting to do something, or we are so obsessed with ourselves that we can't even hear what God is saying because we're not taking time to listen, you see, our heart is far from God. And God is saying, come, and let me help you get your heart right. There's people who confess him with their mouth, Jesus said, but your heart is far from me. May we be sensitive to this issue. You see, the sinful act is painful, but what it reveals about the heart is devastating. And it's devastating to your relationship to God. Now look at Hosea chapter 11 and verse 8. And this is one of those passages that we look at and we say, injure the Lord, hurt the Lord. Look at Hosea chapter 11 and verse 8. Oh, how can I give you up, Ephraim? This is another name for Israel. How can I let you go, O Israel? How, this is God speaking, how can I destroy you like Admah and demolish you like Zoboam? My heart, underline it, is torn within me, and my compassion does what? That's how much God loves you. The heart of God is torn over you. This is God loving you first when you don't love him. This is 1 John in action. We love because he first loved us. This is the true message of the gospel. So, oh, that we would see the gross adultery of Gomer in its mirror effect. That we see her, and perhaps the image is our face looking back at us. Well, number five is a good place for us to wind this first message down. I want you to see it. We will see in the coming messages, God's corrective judgment, and that it ultimately flows from unrelenting love. God's judgment is not fueled by his wrath and his anger alone over our sin. But ultimately, the thing that rides over it all is his unrelenting love. And that's what we see Hosea showing us with his own obedience to God toward Gomer, who rejects him. So God's corrective judgment, you know, so often we think of judgment as simply the wrath of God being poured out upon sin. And indeed, for the wicked, that is the case. But for God's children, we begin to see his judgment is what saves us and corrects us and pulls us back to him. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. Whom the Lord loves, he corrects. Whom the Lord loves, he spanks. And this is his unrelenting love. You see, his judgment is real. Fill that in. His judgment is real. And it is intense. But it is also corrective, as we've said. And it is redemptive. You see, God just doesn't leave you in your brokenness, but he comes and he rescues you and restores you in the midst of that. I know that we're here at the last line, and I don't want you to miss Hosea chapter 14 and verse 4. When I was a freshman in college at Florida State University, this verse gripped my heart, and I want you to see it. At the end of Hosea's writing, at the end of this message, we will see that God declares this: I will heal their apostasy. What is apostasy? Apostasy means leaving the Lord, leaving the God who loves you, leaving the one who has delivered you. He says, I will heal their apostasy. And I love this. Look at the next part. I will love them freely, for my anger has turned from them. If we did not have a God who loves us freely, there would be no hope. There would be no hope for Andrew Coleman to live Monday on this life saying that he's a Christian, hoping to love and live for God. It would be impossible for Ashley, who was baptized, to say, I want to obey the Lord all of my life. Because you know what? She's going to fail. Just like you. You're going to fail. You're going to love other things. What we have is a God who says, come to me. I will love you freely. I will heal your running away from me. Would you stand with me for prayer?